Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. There's a wonderful session coming up. In this festival, we are commemorating, along with the rest of the world, 150 years of the saint of Sabarmati. We remember the 1930 Dandi March by Mahatma Gandhi and the salt satyagraha in the civil disobedience movement he initiated. This one act completely transformed the tone and tenor of the Indian struggle for freedom. Conscious resistance along with non-violence became the powerful new strategies for waging political battles against the British. In his book, The Disobedient Indian, Ramin Jahan Begaloo looks at dissent as a political tool for the individual to assert his right to be heard and heeded. Democracy, to be worthy of obedience, he says, must be structured so that every citizen can question and disobey unjust laws and institutions. This is the message he urges us to take from the greatest thinker of our times, Mahatma Gandhi. Ramin Jahan Begaloo is author of 28 books and winner of the Peace Prize from the United Nations Association in Spain for his extensive academic work in promoting dialogue between cultures. In conversation with him is another Gandhi expert, Bindu Puri, author of 2 books on Gandhi, The Tagore-Gandhi Debate on Truth and Untruth, and Gandhi and the Moral Life. And talking to them and moderating the session will be Sunit Arora, journalist currently working with Mint. I request all of you, Bindu Puri and Ramin Jahan Begaloo and Sunit Arora, please come on the dais.
Good evening, Kasoli. I know our session has been moved once and twice, so apologies for that. But I hope to make it up with an engaging discussion with Ramin and Professor Bindu, who are going to talk about this book, The Disobedient Indian, Towards a Gandhian Philosophy of Dissent. Now, exactly a year ago, I connected with Ramin. I work with Mint newspaper, part of the Hindustan Times group, and I curate something called a daily long story, which is 2,000 words a day, Monday to Friday. And I had decided that over a year's period, we would do many pieces on Gandhi. And Ramin was one of the first authors I reached out to. And he, over the past year, has written many pieces for Mint and elsewhere. And initially, the first piece Ramin wrote for us about a year ago was on Satyagraha and the global importance of Gandhi. And he, at the end of the piece, apart from mentioning the usual suspects who have, you know, the South Africa and the movements there in Poland, he brought up some of the new changes, new movements that have happened over the last 30 years, non-violent movements, which have been influenced by Gandhi. The extensive list, which I must quote, Ukraine, Georgia, Myanmar, Iran, the Palestinian territories, and Egypt and Tunisia. Not all these movements were successful, but the fact is that there was a non-violent component to it. Over the past year, I also sent out reporters all over the country and basically chasing Gandhi's path, chasing going to his birthplace. We went from north to south, the Dandi March, everything. And the message I got from our reporters was a very different message about Gandhi. Typically, it would be something like, there is a deification of Gandhi. Gandhi's ideas won't work in India. There's no place for his views. And even those who follow the truth are left to walk alone in today's world. One of my colleagues went to Porbandar and came up with this memorable quote, which said, remembering him on his birth and death anniversary is almost like a collective ritual that the city cannot afford to let go. Now, it is in these contradictions that Raman's timely and elegant book fall, because Raman has made a call to arms for Indians to go back to Gandhi and to use Gandhi's voice of dissent to reach out with the polity that we are dealing with today. So it's a very timely book, and he basically talks about changes, which he acknowledges some of them, the lack of thought in society today, the increasing violence, the lack of mutual toleration, what we call the Trumpification of politics, the numbing nature of the techno state, the diminution of civil society and Tukre Tukre gang, and of course, the lack of constitutional and judicial process. So these are, in this environment comes his book. And I just briefly summarize the book. It's in two parts. The first part, he describes the philosophical underpinnings of dissent and the importance of why disobedience is necessary, why it's not an invitation to chaos, as some will argue, and why it's constructive. In the second part, he goes deeper into Gandhi's, how Gandhi's form of dissent and disobedience, looking at how his inner truth and satya was coalesced into one brilliant form. Now, as we take this discussion forward, there are obviously these contradictions will come in, and I hope we have a lively discussion. I'll just put out three issues that I feel can come up for discussion. One is obviously Gandhi's use of religion and politics led in some ways to the rise of the Hindu right. So the political constructs of Gandhi, whether I'm not saying he's Hindutva, but they have been used by the same majoritarian approach 70 years later, have been used by the very people who have assassinated him. So we need to understand and bring this to the table while we discuss dissent here. The second point is that no political formation in India today sees that Gandhi is as central, because human inequality and violence have receded from our moral concerns. That is deeply worrying. And when it comes to human inequality, I would like to bring in some debates about caste and Gandhi and caste, and Gandhi and Ambedkar, what their two different approaches were. And finally, I come to the one which actually comes out most in what I call the WhatsApp economy, where Gandhi and non-violence, which is where we come to Raman, is that in many ways, did Gandhi's views of non-violence make us avoid looking at the violence that lies inside us? And he gets criticized a lot for being emasculating Hinduism, because he linked it to his thought. But do we need to talk about violence while we need to talk about why we need to talk about being disobedient and talk about Gandhi? So now I'm going to move to you, Bindu, if you could speak for some time, and then we'll move to you, Raman. Thank you.
And it engages our curiosity, you know, we get into a dogmatic slumber, which is all too easy because of the mundane everyday life with which we get immersed. So Ramin, like Tagore, he reminds us of Gandhi as he stood knocking on the doorsteps of the, you know, millions of Indians. And Tagore says, here is the truth at last. So in that sense, Ramin reminds me of Tagore over here. But since in philosophy, we all have to disagree with each other, and I think this book talks about disagreement, so I'm going to strike a little bit of disagreement in saying that if I'm asked, and I've spent 25 years working on Gandhi, that how would I like to think about Gandhi, then I would say that here is a soldier of truth. And with these words, I'm kind of describing Gandhi as Gandhi describes Socrates. So I would say that the disobedient Indian is also the soldier of truth. And why I prefer the soldier of truth to the disobedient Indian? Because Satyagraha is a wider term than disobedience. He says in 1927 that all civil disobedience is Satyagraha, but all Satyagraha is not disobedience. So Gandhi talks about Satyagraha in different ways. You can do Satyagraha against the society, against the state, against the colonizer, but also against ourselves. And the need for that arises when we, not only against our individual selves, but also against the collective self, in whose sins and violence we may also be implicated. At that point, Satyagraha doesn't take the shape of disobedience, but of penance, of tapasya. So the great poet Rabindranath Tagore famously called Gandhi the great tapasya. And also, if you look at disobedience itself, it can, you know, it's one part of the Satyagraha. The Satyagraha also is about non-cooperation, passive resistance. And Gandhi famously said, look, spinning is also Satyagraha. And, you know, if you do selfless service, that's also Satyagraha. What about this disobedience itself? Now, there are two points about Gandhian disobedience which make it different from any kind of disobedience we know. Firstly, this is not a petulant disobedience. It is a very selective disobedience and always in the interest of a higher truth. And secondly, to me, which is very important, this disobedience is constitutively linked with a skepticism about your own position. Agar aaj dekho, is anyone skeptical when they are being disobedient or when they are challenging things? It's always that the truth is on my side. But Gandhi made it very clear that Satyagraha is an openness to being convinced as much as it is an openness to convincing others. So this skepticism is very important because it's linked with the huge humility that Gandhi saw in Satyagraha. And there also, now how does Gandhi keep up this, you know, constitutive relationship between disobedience and skepticism, which is such a difficult relationship? We are not able to do it. How does he do it? I think he does it because, one, he talks about not everybody can be a disobedient. Disobedience is a very exacting notion. So Gandhi says, look, you have to be qualified. You have to have prerequisites for being a Satyagrahi. In which he talks about things like not having, you know, being totally disinterested in wealth, being totally, you know, following all kinds of virtue. And here I was just telling Ramin that in that sense, Gandhi is not a heretic because he does engage with the Indian tradition. And he actually speaks about virtues, which he takes from the Yog Sutra by Patanjali. So he has this interesting critical relationship with the Indian tradition, which is also at the same time continuous at some points. Second thing is that just by resisting, you can't be autonomous. To be autonomous for Gandhi is to be self-ruled, to be self-restrained. Not let the self take you away. So that's very important. But having said that, I'll say that what this book does is that it tells us to sum up that Gandhian courage in this chartless, you know, sea of Indian politics. And it's interesting, I want to say something that Gandhi said. And he said, I'm the keeper of the lighthouse called Satyagraha in the otherwise chartless sea of Indian politics. And I think one thing this book does is very, you know, wonderfully, it asks us to turn to this beacon light and to sum up the courage to question, to be critical. And the wonderful insights that have been brought cover a whole range of discussion in Western philosophy from people like Aristotle, right, Hannah Arendt and various other people. So it's totally brilliant and also coming at a very timely moment, asking us to be critical, to question, but do it with a whole lot of discipline. And I think it's easier to follow than to be disobedient with discipline. And with that, I think I should ask Ramin to say something.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. I'm very happy to be here. And I have to be thankful to Niloufer and to all her collaborators, the board of trustees who have invited me here. Very nice to be here, share this panel with you. And very nice to have Sunit and Bindu to comment on my work. Now, let me start by saying that the book that I've written actually stands in a long, I would say, long tradition of philosophical thought with which I've been interacting since I was a student in France and later on teaching in Canada. I have to explain a little bit more about myself. You will understand a little bit more why I'm an outsider. But I'm not only an outsider to India, I'm practically outsider to every culture in which I've lived. I've lived in 7 different countries and traveled to 40. And this is why how I got interested in Gandhi. Actually, I'm Iranian born, French brought up, Canadian citizenship, and I've been teaching in Canada, and I've done part of my studies also in America. So for me, approaching Gandhi actually is approaching somebody who is very intercultural. I'm trying to humanize Gandhi. You saw that in the introduction which was given, again, we mentioned, Gandhi was mentioned as a saint, as somebody of transcendental, as a Mahatma. And if we approach Gandhi as a Mahatma, as a father of the nation, we will always use him, as it's the case these days, mostly by politicians. We're going to use him on the posters, we're going to miss the essence of his message, and we're not going to be faithful and loyal actually to his life, which was actually his message, as he said. Now, I'm very thankful to Bindu when she compares me to Tagore. Actually, I worked on Tagore also, but I take that as a Persian because Tagore came to Persia. He loved Persia. He loved the Persian poets, as you know, like Hafiz and Saadi. So it's an honor to be compared with Tagore. Yet, I think that there is something special about Gandhi which we might not find in Tagore, despite the fact that I like very much when Tagore criticizes nationalism, because I think nationalism is one of the worst diseases ideologically that we have in the world, everywhere. And so we need to be inspired more and more by people who have criticized nationalism. Tagore is one, George Orwell is the second one, Bernard Shaw, third person. And of course, we have many different thinkers, French thinkers, British thinkers. Now, I think that what is special about Gandhi, which I'm trying to approach, Gandhi is a dissenter. He's a resistant. He's a resister also. And if we go to the root of the word dissent or resistance, it comes from Latin, which means to take a stand. Gandhi is a person who takes a stand, and he takes it very toughly. I always say I didn't want to have Gandhi as a father. He was a very bad father. You see how he deals with Harilal, actually. But I like to have him as the way I've been working on him for the past 30 years of my life, and been writing in different languages, French, English, and Persian. Gandhi is somebody who's still standing out. He's still an outsider. And I would like to read him as an outsider. And this is where I would not see him as a soldier, as a Satyagrahi soldier. I think he goes even beyond Satyagraha, because Satyagraha is only a technique. It's not a philosophy in the way that I'm portraying Gandhi. Actually, Gandhi is a very Socratic character. You know, before writing this book, I published a book in America which is called Gadflies in the Public Space, Socratic Legacy of Dissent. And Gandhi is one of the characters, actually. But we have also Henry David Thoreau, who influenced Gandhi. But also Martin Luther King, who was influenced by both of them. Okay? Now, the way that we need to read Gandhi is how Gandhi is relevant not to be only on our posters around Delhi and Mumbai, but how Gandhi can be, how can we read Gandhi as an outsider, as a radical person, as a dissenter, as an somebody who stands out and helps us actually to go against populist regimes, populist leaders, against lies which are actually summing up in our world, make changes, I would say. So what is the most important in Gandhi, which is practically never mentioned, especially by Indian politicians or corporate minds, is that Gandhi wanted to make a revolution of values. Revolution of values. He wanted to change the values, not only of the Indian society, but of the world in general. So what is this revolution that he wanted to make? And this is the question that I'm asking. Actually, it was a very Socratic self-examination. You know, what is important in Gandhi, which I think that is very closely related to the idea of disobedience, because we have, and this is the title of one of my books, we have the moral obligation to disobey unjust laws. As Henry David Thoreau says, as Gandhi says, as Martin Luther King says, and as I would say wise people mostly say. Because we cannot live with unjust laws. Actually, today's world, we are continuously becoming more and more conformist, more and more complacent. We lie to each other, we lie to ourselves, and we accept everything which is forced to us. It's incredible when you watch the TV in the morning. I start watching the BBC World Service and the French TV. Incredible. Today, I mean, look what Erdogan is doing with the Kurds. And nobody is talking about it. People are getting massacred. How many times people should get massacred? We had the Holocaust, we had ex-Yugoslavia, we had one after the other. I mean, you have your own pages of history of partition and many other things. How many times? And why people don't speak up? And now, Gandhi is somebody who had the moral courage. And people, and this is where I say intercultural reading of Gandhi comes in, because I've been either meeting these people or working on them, and I'm going to name them. You name some of them. Václav Havel, Dalai Lama, you know. But people, these are the people I've met. But people, you have Martin Luther King, you have Mandela, and many others, okay? Now you see, these people, they understood very well that they have to go against the tides. Mandela goes against ANC when he becomes president. You see the movie Invictus, how he managed with the rugby game, World Cup. Martin Luther King, when he started criticizing the Vietnam War, and that's why they shot him mainly for that, many of the African Americans who were working with him said, this is dangerous, don't do that. He said, I cannot not talk about it. Because segregation, poverty in the ghettos, and Vietnam War, there are a continuous line. And this continuity, we have it practically everywhere. Everywhere. So, what I think that Gandhi is a gadfly, mainly. This is the reading that I have. He's giving us the bravery, the moral courage of being outspoken, to question things. You know, the thing that we're not doing, the act of dissent is mainly the act of questioning about what's going on. And the definition that people like Gandhi have of politics. Of politics. Politics, and this is how he's Socratic and very Greek actually, politics is the art of organizing the society. It's not about power shifting and party politics. Who said that politics is only about, about party politics? This is actually a very modern view and contemporary view of politics, where it doesn't exist for a person like Gandhi. That's why his vision of democracy is a criticism. You find a criticism of Marxism, a criticism of liberal values. He says rights are not enough, we need to have duties. And what he says mostly, which goes in the direction of what I've been writing about, you cannot be an immature citizen. Because you see right now in India, being an immature citizen and going just to vote, what will be the result in the long term? What is mostly important is to have a civic friendship, which Gandhi actually had. I think that Gandhi, what is the most important thing in him, which nobody talks about, is the idea of civic friendship. It's not the idea of national membership. You're Indian because you have civic friendship for another Indian, but also for non-Indians. It's not because you have an Indian passport. This is not what makes you an Indian. So, to make it short, I think that what is important, and Gandhi's reading of Gandhi actually brings out for me, is also is self-governance, intellectual self-governance, political self-governance, you know? And all this needs a great deal of questioning, of dissenting, of resisting, of going against the tide, and it has nothing to do with being an anarchist, you know? I think that this is not correct to say as soon as we start questioning, we are an anarchist. No, we have to question the status quo, otherwise we become voluntary slaves, you know? And this is how people who have read Gandhi, actually they all criticize their regimes. They practically all have been, they had this heroic life of dissent. And we can just name it today even around the world. Today I think that what high school kids are doing, which is shameful to people who are older, the older generation, is that they're using Gandhi actually to question, you know, the whole corporate mind and the whole technological basis which is destroying our earth. But they have the courage of doing it. We don't have the courage of doing it, you know? We don't. Okay, I think I stopped here.
Yes, I was going to add that the recent environment protests all over the world also had an air of civil disobedience. To bring it to the present, to Bindu and Ramin, why has the argumentative Indian become so quiet today? And how can we get the inner Gandhi out there? Why do you think the dissidence and the disobedience that you expect in a society, where is it gone? I'd like some thoughts on this, please.
Gandhi spoke about the absence of fear. That we need that kind of courage. First of all, we have to have a courage ourselves. And secondly, we have to give that absence of fear to others as an abhaydan, as a gift of fearlessness. So that's where dissent can come. If we are ourselves fearless, then we'd be able to be compassionate with those who are different from us. Because what is compassion and empathy? Eventually, we have to be able to identify with others and yet resist them. Because civil disobedience, like Ramin said, is civil. It's a friendship. So we can dissent while still being civil, still being friendly. And all this comes from being courageous ourselves and giving others courage, giving others fearlessness towards ourselves. And for, I think that is the first moment from where dissent can come.
Ramin.
Yes, I think that you know, Gandhi's idea of happiness was not ours. Most of you sitting here, let me be very outspoken and frank with you. Your idea of happiness would be to have a cottage at Kasoli, one in Goa, one house in Mumbai, one house in Delhi, and you would say this is happiness. And sending your kids to North America to study. Okay, most of you have done that. So this is not what Gandhi actually thinks, and I tell you why. Now the explanation, philosophical explanation, should follow. For Gandhi, public space and private space are not separated. In modernity, all the whole political theory, modern political theory, is based on the separation of the private sphere and the public sphere. Meaning, as that's why we talk, liberals talk about negative liberty. Negative liberty means how much freedom I have in regard to the power, to the central power, the centralized power, the state. And I want to keep my private sphere intact as much as I can. You know, this is Isaiah Berlin, with whom I did the book. So, and of course you have French authors of 19th century, Benjamin Constant, who says
don't want to do politics like the Greeks. We don't have the time to come to the agora and vote. We want to actually get the pleasure of our private sphere. Get the pleasure. He actually mentioned the word jouir, having pleasure in French. Okay. Now for Gandhi, that wasn't the case. The best example that we have actually been discussed in the past 2 weeks with Manu's diaries is that Gandhi, when even he practices his brahmacharya, he does it very publicly. He has no shame. He says, I want to go bed with a young girl and old nude, and this is because I'm exercising again my spirituality and my chastity. I want to see if everything is okay. So the private and public are not separated. Now, if we come to the idea of violence and fearlessness, Chori Chora is the best example, one of the examples. The other example is during the partition in Calcutta. Gandhi, actually, he's fearless. He stops a movement. He says, I'm not going to be with you, or I resist you. I will fast until I die. I will resist you because I think you are wrong, what you're doing. So that, I say, is going against the tide. And moral leaders, which we are lacking in today's world, because we have a lot of politicians, but we don't have moral leaders. Just name me one moral leader after the death of Mandela and Václav Havel. No moral leaders, you know? And more populist leaders with a big mouth shouting on the roofs, but not actually providing anything for the citizens. That's the problem. That we are. Look at Donald Trump, look at Austria, look at Hungary, Orban, look at Erdogan. It's just massing. It's just getting more and more intense. And it's very dangerous, actually. And we have to ask a deep question about ourselves as citizens of the world. How we are voting for people, how we are bringing them to power, and what's going to happen at the end. So that's very, very important. We have... Now, Gandhi is actually not doing that. So the reading that I have of him is, if I'm sitting today, you know, I went to jail in Iran. If I am sitting in Iran today and I'm fighting for my rights and against unjust laws, how can I use Gandhi? How does he speak to me? You know, how does he speak to me? And this is where I think it becomes very, very important.
Yeah, Gandhi on violence is something which is always provocative, because a common reaction to the non-violence is a repulsion right now, which you hear quite often. And you're right that Gandhi actually had, you know, was very practical about how he dealt with violence.
We got to love this difference. It's not unfortunate. It's actually very fortunate. And Gandhi told us to enlarge the sphere of our own and make otherness just something that we enjoy, like he said. It's all about civic friendship.
Right, I think we are running out of time. At least that's what the bells indicate. Am I correct? We'd like to take some questions from the audience. Please, just identify yourselves and a mic.
Mic.
Can you please pass the gentleman a mic? Please identify yourself. Thank you.
I'm a soldier, Colonel Tyagi.
Right.
My question is to Raymond. What made you choose Gandhi for your studies? Probably that is the biggest draw. Could we have that answer?
Can I answer right now? Very good question. You know, because it helps me to talk a little bit about myself. When I was a student, I studied political science, history, and philosophy, but I did my PhD in philosophy. So, you know, for a long period of time, I've studied revolutions, French Revolution, Russian Revolution, Chinese Revolution, and I did my master's in history on Clausewitz. So, you know, I tried to understand First World War, Second World War, theories of war. And then I turned towards nonviolence because I thought that it's much very interesting, especially because, as I said, while I was a student in France, I started in 1970s, you know, and I was part of the anti-apartheid movement. I was also working with the Chileans and Argentinians to fight against dictatorships in Latin America, but I was also active for Eastern Europeans, and that's how I got to know a lot of dissidents. I was lucky. I was in a town, in a country where, like in 19th century, you had a lot of exiles, a lot of radical-minded people. Great minds of the century were still alive. You know, they were around. And I wanted to swallow, actually, I would say, knowledge as much as I could, and art also. So that's how it started. I mean, my link with India was always there as an Iranian, because my parents had Indian friends. We knew many Indians. And when I was in Paris, actually, I was friends with people at the Indian Embassy and UNESCO. And I traveled in the 1980s to India. But I was already working with the French nonviolent groups. So I started reading Gandhi, I started reading the other nonviolence, and Gandhi for me became a very important thinker, you know. So I decided to do a work on Gandhi, and it was published, of course, in the late 1990s in French, before starting writing on Gandhi in English. But later in Iran also, actually, I continued on that level, and that's why I went to jail as a nonviolent.
Any more questions?
So, you know, I basically want to
identify yourself.
My name is Harsh Thakur. I'm from Mumbai. I want to ask you, see, it's a great thing about the philosophy of non-violence, but very often there were instances like in Garhwali, when the Hindu and Muslim soldiers wanted to fight, he said, "Why are you disobeying an order?" Then there was a naval rating strike in 1946. See, sometimes, did he not also support, is it not true that sometimes he also, like Bhagat Singh, he opposed people who were not really non-violent. And this was contradictory, like this Garhwali soldiers, naval ratings, like Bhagat Singh, and something to reflect on this. Wasn't there a double side to this?
Would you want to take that, or Bindu, would you want to take that? Bindu?
I didn't understand.
But sometimes, you know, he spoke about non-violence, but when the people non-violently revolted, like in Garhwali, the soldiers, like in the naval rating, like in Bhagat Singh, you know, he opposed them. I mean, I heard him, he even condemned this naval rating strike, it was in the 40s, the Garhwali. These were some instances when people were not really violent. They just were, they were really anti-British. He said, no, that we should oppose this. Now, I thought this was counter, I just want my view. Right?
Well, I think one thing is there in Gandhi, that he's very clear that you should not, you don't have to be against the British or against anybody. You have to be against just their acts. So whenever there is a hostility, whenever there is an incivility in your disobedience, Gandhi will end up not liking that disobedience. Because it's very important for him that you must like the person. You must see there's more to the person than the act that you don't like. So you don't have to be hostile to the British. Right now, we don't have to be even hostile against, let's say, a government which is authoritarian. We have to be only hostile, we have to direct our hostility to that act which we are resisting. And we have to be able to make that distinction. But we can't, actually. I come from JNU, which is a place where there's lots of disobedience happening. And what I see all the time is that the disobedience doesn't only target the bad thing, but targets the person also. And so there is a lot of, there's a lot of hostility floating around on every side. And to me, that's very destructive. I think, why do we have to be hostile to people? We should resist the act, but we don't need to lock up people in a room or in a building to oppose the acts. So I think what Gandhi was saying always was, whenever the hostility turned to people, he became against it. So you had to be able to de-escalate the hostility.
Raman, you want to take this?
Very quickly. Actually, if I can say humbly, you have to de-Indianize Gandhi and non-violence. Why? Because it's true that India actually played a very important role through its religions, actually, to promote non-violence, Jainism, Buddhism, Hinduism. But if we only stick to Gandhi as an Indian, we will have a misunderstanding of why we practice nonviolence in today's world. You know, because we're always going back to Gandhi, the Indian, the father of the nation, somebody who fought against the British. And you will not understand Catalonia today. You will not understand Palestine today. You will not understand women in Iran today. You will not understand everywhere where people are using not violence, but non-violence to get their freedoms.
Okay, so to take this train of thought forward, Ramin, I have a counterfactual question for you. How would Gandhi have reacted to the shutdown in Kashmir right now? What would his satyagraha have been? It's a counterfactual question.
The answer is very easy. Actually, even before Kashmir, I wrote a piece in the Hindu saying that Gandhi will not vote in the Indian elections because he would have been against all the political parties. And let's be frank. I know that some of you are here as present and you're a member of the Congress or BJP or something, but you will not have voted. So he would have been a real dissident against for the Kashmir also, as it was for many other points.
Okay.
I think they want to throw us out.
They do. One last question from the audience. I'm hoping for... Can you please, sir? Yeah. One last question.
10 minutes.
Thank you very much. Very lucid talk on Gandhi's philosophy. Whatever I've read in the books about Gandhi, there were 2-3 contradictions. One was that Gandhi mentioned, he also said that religion should not be mixed with politics. But Gandhi had a different idea. He wanted that religion should be there to keep the politics on track, because religion guides the people to be on the right. The second point I want to ask is, which has become very, very much talking point these days in the Indian politics, is that Gandhi initially was against partition. Then why did he agree? Third is that in actual election, Patel was elected to be the Prime Minister. But why did he, prevail upon Nehru, prevail upon the people, that let Nehru become the Prime Minister? Your comments on that.
Thank you. So I think we'll just stick to the part about religion. Yes, religion and politics, since I brought that up also, about Gandhi's outlook on religion and how he used religion and how that's playing out now. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I'd say that a sane mind is contradictory. And it's not because, it's even if you have a philosophical mind, you contradict yourself, because the world changes also. Now, for Gandhi, I think religion was not that much important, that spirituality was important. That's why he always goes beyond, and he talks about the acid test of reason. He didn't mention it. Acid test of reason that he applies to his reading of the Quran, to his reading of the Vedas, to his reading of Christianity in South Africa. Gandhi is always very, very critical minded, and religion for him, he repeats it all the time. If you go and read the 100 volumes, he says, I don't want to have a dogmatic view of religion. Religion is there to help us to move forward. But if it becomes a dogma and it just obstructs our way to free thinking and free expression, we have to stop.
He says that there's no religion and politics cannot be separated, and he says, look, I think every one of my activities is religious. But by religion, he doesn't mean any sectarian religion. By religion, he means the moral governance of the world, and he locates that moral governance in two things: satya and ahimsa. So in that sense, when he talks about Ram Rajya, he's talking about the kingdom of righteousness, not any Hindu Raj. So that's something we really got to keep in mind.
Thank you. And thank you, Bindu. Thank you, Ramin. Thank you, the audience.